May we come to you with words of praise and sing songs and hymns and glorious praise to our Lord. May we exalt the Lord Jesus Christ in everything we do this morning. May we bless you. We love you and we ask all of this morning in the name of Jesus, our King, and all God's people said, amen. Hey, we have several new ones here today. Get around. Welcome one another.
Good morning. How are you? Good.
Good morning.
All right, you may be seated. Well, we're going to throw a few announcements at you this morning. Nothing too crazy, so we can jump right into worship. Don't waste a lot of time with announcements. But I do want to say a few things. First of all, great men's breakfast yesterday. Appreciate all the fellows that came out. Appreciate Shane's help and willing to meet me here at 4 a.m. yesterday. He met me at 4 a.m. because I wanted to teach him how to make gravy. The last few times he's made gravy, it's been terrible. So I said, hey, meet me at 4 a.m. I'll show you. And he made some great gravy yesterday. It was really good. But no, we have biscuits and gravy. Now, with that, I got a new phone recently, and I downloaded the Remind app again, signed in, all that. Well, when I sent a message out for the reminder, some people got it, and some guys didn't, and some have even told me they got it even after the fact. So I just want to remind everybody, if you're not signed up, or you might even need to do this again because something weird is going on with our Remind app, there are instructions out on the back table as to how you can get into our Remind notification system. You want to do that because if something comes up or we have an event or we need to cancel church for some reason or something like that, that's going to be the way we announce it, is through that app and on our Facebook page. Those are the only two options you have. So especially if you don't have Facebook, you want to make sure that you are signed up in the system. It's super easy. There's a number that you plug into your phone. It's 81010. That's the number you're going to text. And then you send a text, and in the body of the text, it's one little message. @MTVCIA. You just text that, hit send, and it will automatically sign you up in our system. So then you should get a text message. Every time I send one out, it'll just say, hey, men's breakfast at 7 a.m. tomorrow morning, blah, 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 blah. Shane's learning how to make gravy. So if you're not already signed up, please get one of these. They're out the back table. Get signed up in our system. Right now, we have 97 people signed up. We have a lot more than that that's coming regularly, so please get signed up if you haven't already. Enough about that. Wednesday night, please come out and join us. Our middle school youth are going to be meeting along with our men's Bible study that's been going on for a while. I think they are in Matthew 17.
Jeff, does that sound right?
Yeah, 17. There are new questions for Matthew chapter 17 out here on the back table. So that's one option for the fellas. We also, guys and gals alike, you can also join us in here for episode number 4, I believe, of The Chosen. We're working our way through season 1 of The Chosen this summer, so a lot to do. All of that starts at 6:30. Everything on Wednesday night is at 6:30. The following Wednesday night, not this one. Everybody say, not this one.
Not this one.
The following Wednesday night is going to be 4th of July week. I think it's July 6th, Wednesday night. There will be no service Wednesday night, July 6th. So there won't be any Chosen, there'll be no youth gathering, and there will be no men's Bible study. So put that on your calendar. The church will be closed. You're welcome to come and hang out if you want to, but probably won't be very many people here. I think that may be all the announcements we have for right now, which would be awesome. Stay with me, please. Let's ask the Lord to bless our worship today. Well, Lord, I want to thank you for the worship team and the time they put into preparing, because what we're about to do is so very important. And I just pray, Lord, that as we come to you in song, it is more than song. It is so much more than just singing and going through the repetition of songs. I pray that it is an opportunity to clear and declutter our minds from all the busyness of our week, and maybe the storms and the distractions of the things that are going on all around us. Help us to just keep our eyes focused on you in these next few moments as you prepare our hearts for the preaching of your word. I know you have a message for your church today, and so through this worship time, prepare us and make us ready to hear you. We love you, and again, we ask this in Christ's name. Let's worship you.
Thank you.
Gracious, holy God, we praise you this morning. And it is good that the church can come together and sing to a holy God. Lord, not only are you holy, we celebrate the truth that you have made us holy by the blood of the Lamb, by the sacrifice, by the cross. We stand here today totally justified and innocent before you. We are righteous. And Lord, not only have you made us holy, your word tells us that you command us to go out and be what you have made us to be, holy. And we need your help to do that. We need your Holy Spirit, Father, to teach us and instruct us and convict us of sin. Lord, we could not live the holy life if we didn't know what that was. And your word tells us exactly what that is. So this morning, Lord, as we come back to the scripture, we ask for your help. We pray, Lord, for just the illumination, the illuminating power of the Holy Spirit to speak powerfully in all of our hearts and our lives this morning. May we hear this good seed that's getting ready to be cast. May we hear it, believe it, and act upon it. May we be transformed by it. We love you, and we ask this all again in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you. You can be seated. Thank you so much. We're going to let our ushers come forward and give you a chance to continue to worship the Lord in your giving. Appreciate our worship team. Give them a big hand. Kids, you can head on out to kids' church. Don't get lost wandering around out there. Behave yourselves. You can't be hitting your brother. That's a rule. Do that at home. Your parents love that. Hey, grab your Bibles this morning if you would. As the kids are heading out, turn to Luke chapter 16. One more time, we are going to read verses 19, and today we're going to stop at verse 26, and then we'll pick up with the rest of the chapter in just a moment. Luke chapter 16 and verse 19. Jesus is telling a parable here, and he says that there was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and he saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame. But Abraham said, Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things, but now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great chasm that has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us. Today we come back to the Gospel of Luke, and specifically we come to another one of our Lord's very famous parables. It's been called the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. Today will be our third and final study of this parable. And I want to do just a quick review for those of you that maybe have not been with us the last few weeks, or maybe you're like me and you can't hardly remember from one week to the next what you heard. When we started this study, I said that we were going to do it in three parts, and it's actually turned out to be four. We covered the first two sections of this parable, which is described with the description of the two men, the wealthy man and Lazarus, the poor man. We also talked about the death of these two men, and we talked about how death is going to come to all of us. And another similarity that we got into last week is the two destinations. Everybody will end up in one of two destinations. Nothing in between, no third option. Everyone's going to one place or another, and it's one of the destinations that one of these two men ended up in. We devoted our entire study last week to these two destinations, and I shared with you four points regarding these two destinations. I'll quickly run through them. Point number one. The destination of these two men had absolutely nothing to do with their wealth or their poverty. The rich man did not go to hell because he was rich. Lazarus did not get to go to heaven because he was poor. It was a heart condition. It is the condition of our heart that will always determine our eternal destination. In our second point last week, we talked a little bit about the destination of Lazarus. The scriptures say that he was taken immediately by angels to Abraham's bosom, or Abraham's side. And we talked a little bit about what that meant and didn't mean, and for the sake of time, we're just saying that it is synonymous with heaven. So Lazarus goes to heaven where Abraham is at. The parable does spend a lot more time on the destination of the rich man, which was our third point. We learn quite a bit more about hell in this parable than we do heaven. Matter of fact, there's very little even said about the place where Lazarus is at with Abraham. There's quite a bit said about the place that the rich man was at in hell. Point number four of last week's message involved this chasm. So the rich man, of course, calls out, Abraham, send Lazarus here so he can comfort me. And Abraham basically says, we can't do that. The way that God has created things is there's this world, and then there's life after this life, and in life after this life, it's divided into two locations, heaven and hell, and apparently God has created it the way that there's a chasm, a great divide, where people in hell cannot cross over into heaven. People in heaven will not be able to cross over into hell. And I shared with you last week, my personal opinion is that people in heaven and hell cannot cross over to come back here either. I know there might be a couple of exceptions to that in the scriptures, but as a general rule, I just don't believe that's so. Today I want to pick up where we left off last week, and it's kind of right in the middle of the parable. And I want you to look back at verse 27, and we're going to finish reading the parable now. The rich man speaks after Abraham tells him, I'm sorry, there's nobody can cross over to you, and you can't cross over to us. Verse 27, the rich man says, Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But Abraham said, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. And Abraham said to him, If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. So today there are three points I want to share with you from these five verses. This is kind of an outline of where we're going. I had a slide up there for today. First of all, verses 27 and 28, we're going to see the serious need for evangelism. Verse 28, we're going to see the sufficiency of Scripture. And in verses 30 and 31, we're going to come to the summit of this glorious parable that I've been talking about for the last 3 weeks. I want us to go to verse 27 today, and I want us to see the serious need for evangelism. The rich man in this story begs Abraham to send Lazarus to his brothers. Why? Does he want Lazarus to go tell them what happened to the brother that's dead? No. He says, go send Lazarus to my brothers that he may warn them so that they will not come into this place of torment. I've been saying some pretty sobering things the last couple weeks, and I'm going to say some tough things again here today. Heaven and hell are going to and are already filled with people of various kinds. Heaven and hell is filled with people who are wealthy and poor in this life. Heaven and hell are filled with people of all nationalities, all tribes, all languages, all people groups. So if you have a problem with people who look and sound differently than you do, you're going to feel really out of place for all of eternity in either place you go. Because of both heaven and hell, there's going to be various kinds of people from all tribes, nations, people groups all around the world. But I'm going to tell you one thing that both groups have in common. Heaven and hell are full of the most powerful would-be evangelists we've ever seen. What I mean by that, and I often say this in a lot of funeral messages that I've done, if God would allow, if he would close the chasm, if he would pull back the veil and let some people in heaven or maybe some people in hell, if he would allow them to speak to us today, even for 5 minutes, I know exactly what that conversation would sound like. I do not believe for a moment somebody speaking to us from heaven would run around and be asking, hey, how are the kids? How are the grandkids? What are you guys been up to? Talk fast, because I've been gone for a while. Wouldn't be any of that. You know what they'd say? The gospel is true, and heaven is glorious, and you need to experience it. They would say, you don't want to miss this. It's awesome. Jesus is there. God on the throne is glorious. It's wonderful. That's what those 5 minutes would sound like. It would sound similar from those in hell. If God would let them speak to us, and I told you this at my close of my message last week, there's not a single unbeliever in hell right now. They have gotten there and they have realized, I got it wrong. I missed it. Hell is full of people right now who would say, oh, if I could go back, I would tell my mom and my dad and my brothers and my sisters and my kids or my grand, I would beg with them. If they could have 5 minutes, it would sound like, the gospel is true. I was wrong. You don't want to come here. That's exactly what this rich man was saying to Abraham. Send Lazarus, warn my brothers, tell them they don't want to come to this place. But here's the reality, folks. God's not going to close up the chasm. He's not going to pull back the veil. He's not going to let any of our loved ones come back and tell us what they see or what they experience. That's our job. That's why we exist. That's the job of the church. Hell is a terrible place, and our Lord takes no pleasure in anybody going there. Heaven is glorious, and he is totally pleased when people go there. So he's given us very clear teaching in his word about the glory of heaven and the horrors of hell. And then he said to his church, get this, the last words Jesus ever spoke to his disciples before he ascended to be with the Father was this: all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I am with you always to the end of the age. I'm with you. Why is he with us? So we can have these warm, fuzzy feelings. Ooh, I can really sense it. He's with you while you evangelize. Because that's why we exist. That's why we're here. Is to warn people of the terrors of hell and the glory of heaven. The apostles caught on to this truth. This became their mantra, their message. The apostle Paul, a few years after this writing, he was writing the church of Rome, and he says in Romans 10, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. I love that promise. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And then he adds this in verse they call on him in whom they have not believed? How are they going to believe in him of whom they have never heard? How are they going to hear without someone preaching and declaring the truth to them? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. If you miss everything else these past few weeks, this is one thing I hope and pray you take from this series. We got to share the gospel. We've got to get serious about evangelism. You can't leave it to your preacher or to an evangelist. You got to talk about it with your lost loved ones, your friends, your relatives, your sons, your daughters, your brothers, your sisters. Bring it up. Well, they might get offended. Hey, they're going to be a lot more offended in the next life, I can assure you. That brings us to point number two. I want to talk with you about the sufficiency of Scripture. This poor man, the rich man in hell tells Abraham, send Lazarus, tell him to go warn my brothers. And I want you to see in verse 29, Abraham's response. He says, they have Moses and the prophets. They need to listen to Moses and the prophets. Moses and the prophets, we've talked about this before, that means the law and the prophets. So if I could paraphrase in today's modern vernacular, that would be, they have their Bible, let them listen to their Bible. They have the Word of God, let them listen to it. Now, this is a great time, and I think this may be the last time that you're going to hear it for a while. The last few weeks, I've been telling you that the context of this parable is so important to remember to really understand what it's about. Jesus is speaking to a crowd of people made up of his disciples, tax collectors, sinners, scribes, and Pharisees. And the thing that launched him into all these parables in the last two chapters are the scribes and the Pharisees who are like, I can't believe he eats the sinners. He receives them, and he eats the tax collectors and sinners. Right? So they're over there grumbling about Jesus. And that launches him into a series of parables. He is speaking to the crowd, but who's he really talking about in all these parables? The scribes and the Pharisees. Every one of them. And I love what he does in these parables, just like he did in the parable of the father with the two lost sons. You don't catch it till you get right to the end. But here Jesus says, the rich man says, send somebody from the dead. They'll repent. And he says, they have Moses and the prophets. Guess who in the crowd were experts in Moses and the prophets? The scribes and the Pharisees. They were teachers of the law. Once again, in this parable, Jesus is pointing the crowds to the hypocritical, self-serving, loveless, and cold, cold hearts of their leaders. He's saying, you don't want to be like them. They're not the people you think they are. They're not the people they think they are. So I was typing these notes yesterday, and I typed that little line. I was reminded of one of my favorite quotes. It's by an old preacher named David Wilkerson. He passed away back in 2011. But for many years, he was the founder of Times Square Church in New York City. He was also wrote the famous book that went around for many years back in the 70s called The Cross and the Switchblade. He's also the founder of Teen Challenge International. I believe him to be a man of God. I didn't agree with all of his doctrinal stands, but I believe this man heard from God. And I used to get his monthly, maybe it was weekly, newsletter. I would always read these newsletters. And I remember in one of the letters, he made a statement that just stuck with me for all these years. David Wilkerson said, the coldest hearts in the world are not the atheistic God-haters. It's not the people marching through the cities and streets of our towns with signs that say God is dead or God is a myth. Those are not the coldest hearts in the world. Coldest hearts of the people who fill a seat at their local church week after week, service after service, hearing the word of God proclaimed and go totally unchanged by the power of it. That's the coldest heart you'll ever experience. You see, folks, hearing the word is really not enough. If it were, Jesus would not have called the Pharisees sons of the devil. Believing in the Word of God is not even enough. You know the devil believes the Word? He knows that every piece of this is true. He believes it. So did the scribes and the Pharisees, and yet Jesus called them a pile of snakes and a graves full of dead men's bones. We must hear it, we must believe it, and we must allow the Scriptures to point us to the Savior who transforms us and calls us to submit to His Lordship. That's the piece they were missing. They heard the Scriptures, they taught the Scriptures, they memorized the Scriptures, they believed it all to be true, but yet where they failed was they absolutely would not submit. They would not submit their lives to the Lordship of Christ and recognize Him as their Messiah. This is what Jesus was trying to get across to them in John chapter 5, verse 39, when He looks and He says this to Pharisees, by the way, "You study the Scriptures diligently because you think that in the Scriptures you have eternal life. These are the very Scriptures that testify about Me." In other words, you can study the Scripture, you can memorize it, you can read it, and you can still miss salvation because you've not allowed the Scriptures to point you to Jesus. But I do want to come back to the sufficiency of Scripture for just a moment, because I don't want you to get the message that maybe the Bible isn't enough. It is enough. As a matter of fact, the doctrine of the sufficiency of Scripture is one of the fundamental doctrines of the Christian faith. By fundamental, I mean, and I say this all the time, there are things we can disagree about. I have friends in this church right now that have very different theological views on certain issues than I do. And it's okay, because we agree on the fundamental doctrines of the Christian faith. And I wish I had time this morning to run through all those with you, but I don't. We'd be here for several hours. But there is one fundamental doctrine that we see here in this parable, and it is the fundamental doctrine of the sufficiency of Scripture. Let me explain what I mean. The doctrine of the sufficiency of Scripture means that the Bible is all we need to equip us for a life of faith and service. We don't need any other books, no other writings. The Bible is sufficient. It gives us everything we need to live a life that glorifies Him. This is one of the reasons that the evangelical Christian church, we often separate ourselves from Mormons. We don't necessarily believe that Mormons are brothers and sisters in Christ. Why? Because they deny the sufficiency of Scripture. They believe that, yes, this is the Bible, but they also have the Book of Mormon. And they give it equal status and equal authority. And we say, that's heresy. We can't stand with you on that. It's one of the reasons we don't stand with Jehovah's Witnesses. They believe in the Bible, but they made their own Bible called the New World Translation of the Bible. They also have the Watchtower Writings. They believe these are divine writings that support or teach equal to Scripture. And we say, it's not. Therefore, we can't stand with you. There's even to some degree where we have to break unity with Catholics and Catholicism. Catholics do believe in the Bible. They believe it is the inspired Word of God. But if you've ever grown up around Catholics or in the Catholic Church, you know that the Catholic teaching stands on what they call a three-legged stool: Scripture, sacred tradition, and the teaching authority of the Pope and the bishops. All three of those carry equal authority: Scripture, church tradition, and basically the Pope and his bishops. They all have the same power and the same authority. And we say, uh-uh. This is what separates the evangelical church apart from all those other groups and other people around the world. We hold to the Reformation doctrine of what is called sola scriptura. That's a Latin term. It means Scripture alone. Scripture is sufficient. We don't need any other divine writings. We don't need some angel showing up or some prophet giving us golden tablets and all that other stuff. We don't need it. We got everything we need right here. This is exactly what Abraham told the rich man. Please, send somebody. He says, no. They have what they need. Let them listen. They have the Scriptures. They have Moses and the prophets. This is what Paul was preaching when he wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3:16. Please, don't miss this. All Scripture is God-breathed. It is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness. Listen to verse 17. So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Do you know what equips you for every good work? That. This book may not tell us everything we want to know about everything, but it does tell us everything we need to know as to how to live a life that honors and glorifies God. It answers the questions you need to know. Now, I'm going to tell you that the rich man in hell, he didn't believe in the sufficiency of Scripture. You know how I know this? Look at verse 30. Rich man says, "No, Father Abraham! If someone would just go to them from the dead, that will do it." In other words, if something supernatural were to occur, if some miracle would happen, that'll convince them. And if they saw that, they would repent and they'd turn from their evil ways. I got to be careful because sometimes it sounds like I'm dogging on other religions and I'm not. But I am going to tell you, I grew up in a particular movement that I'm okay not being in anymore. And I have brothers and sisters in Christ who are still in that movement. But I will tell you, one of the things I grew up in, I grew up seeing and hearing all the time, it happened in Sunday morning church, Sunday night church, happened a lot in our prayer meetings. People would come together, and oftentimes, in a very exuberant, loud, exciting, boisterous way, people would begin to cry out to God, and they'd say, "Oh God, please God, do something new. Do something fresh." I heard that word a lot. "Oh, we are craving some fresh move of the Spirit. Do something exciting tonight. Jazz us up, Lord. Fire us up. Do something exciting. Do something extraordinary." And I often heard this: "Do something supernatural." I appreciate their zeal and their desire, but I believe it is a zeal without knowledge. And I'll tell you why. Because God has brought me, by His grace, God has brought me to a place where I have come to see that the Scripture is new and fresh and exciting and extraordinary. It is supernatural. It transforms people's lives. It changes the world. I've gotten to a point where I just don't need all that other high-energy stuff. I just don't. The Scripture and the Scripture alone is sufficient to equip me and you for every good work. Everything God wants of you, He gives you the questions, the answers to how to do it right here. Everything you need to know right now. So with all of that said, and everything we've covered over the past few weeks, we have finally traversed our way back and forth up this glorious mountain, this parable, and we have came to the summit. I told you in week one, the summit of this great parable is right here in verse 30 and 31. Jesus does it again. He goes through, it's not really a long parable, but he gives a pretty detailed parable, and he waits till right at the very end to hit us with the oomph. Here is exactly where he was going. This is the main point of the parable. "Father Abraham, if somebody just go back from the dead, they would believe, they would repent." And Abraham says in verse 30, 31, he says to him, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced that someone should rise from the dead." It dawned on me for the first time in this series, as I was developing these notes, Jesus is actually speaking prophetically here. Matter of fact, he knows that this is getting ready to happen. Someone's getting ready to come back from the dead, and these same people are not going to be convinced. You might remember back at Easter, we covered the resurrection of Christ. Matthew chapter 27, it tells us Jesus was crucified, and a rich man comes and requests that his body be taken down, and he lays him in his own tomb, Joseph of Arimathea. And in Matthew chapter 27, it says, "The next day, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate. And they said, 'Sir, we remember how that impostor said while he was still alive that after 3 days I will rise. Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people that he is risen from the dead, and the last fraud will be worse than the first.' Pilate said to them, 'You have a guard of soldiers. Go make it as secure as you can.' So they went and they made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard." Most of you are probably familiar with the story. We go over it every Easter. They have their own guards surrounding the tomb. There's a seal around the tomb. One of the gospel accounts says that there's a great earthquake, and the stone rolls back, and an angel appears, and the guards, it says they fall down like dead men. Ooh, they're frozen. I would be too. We would all have a freak out moment. Wow, that tomb just rolled away. There's an angel, and the women show up at the tomb. And the guard looks at the women, and he says, why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's risen. He's not here. And they're blown away. And they all go off to tell the disciples. And then there in Matthew 28, it picks up with the guards who were there at the tomb. It says, while they were going, behold, some of the guards went into the city. I want you to see this. They told the chief priests all that had taken place. They told the chief priests about the angel, the earthquake, the empty tomb, the folded up grave clothes inside the tomb. They told them all of it. You would have thought in that moment the chief priests would have torn their garment. Oh, we missed it. We were wrong. We crucified our own Messiah. God, Father God, forgive us. There wasn't any of that. You know how they responded? Verse 12. When they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers. And they said, tell people that his disciples came by night and stole him while you all were asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble. So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jews even to this day. The rich man in the Lord's parable said, if there was just a resurrection from the dead, they would believe. Jesus is speaking prophetically here, and he's saying, there's going to be a resurrection from the dead, and they're still not going to believe. That's a hard matter of fact. When they heard the eyewitness accounts of this, they bribed people to lie about what they knew was true. That's some cold, cold hearts, isn't it? These are religious people. These are people who grew up hearing and memorizing and teaching Scripture. The whole point of this parable is this. Even our Lord's resurrection was not going to be enough to convince Israel's leaders that they were wrong, that they crucified the long-awaited Messiah. So in telling this story, Jesus presents us with the dreadful yet glorious truth of the gospel, and this is it. It all boils down to this. There will be those who hear the truth. They might even see fruit of it in other people's lives, but they aren't going to believe it. They're still going to refuse it. At the same time, the death and resurrection of Jesus has brought salvation to millions of people ever since the resurrection, and it continues to today. And folks, at the end of the day, it's your choice. Believe it or not. Here's the truth. We'll present it to you. And you need to know, as the church, you know what our message is? We have no obligation whatsoever to save people. We don't do that. Our job is to cast seed. Get out there and throw the seed of the gospel. Share this truth from the sufficiency of Scripture. Cast those seeds, and some of those seeds are going to get spit back in your face. Some of those seeds people are going to trample on. Some of those seeds are going to find good ground, and it's going to start to break a little fruit, and someone's going to be like, ah, this isn't for me. Some of those seeds are going to find good ground. It's going to bring forth really good fruit. And your casting of the seed is going to be a catalyst of bringing people to Christ, and they will escape this eternal wrath that has come on those who don't receive the gospel. That's our mission. It's why we exist. It's part of why we exist. Not only do we cast seed, not only do we want to see people come to faith in Christ, then our job is to bring those in. Those who receive the seed into good ground, we want to bring them in, we want to teach them, we want to train them in everything that Jesus has said. That's why we come together every week and do what we do. But we've got to do the work out there too. I have unsaved friends and loved ones. These past few weeks have challenged me. It dawned on me that 95% of my Jesus talk was with other Jesus followers. I love to talk about Jesus and the Scriptures with other believers.
I got to start talking about it more with unbelievers. They got to hear it. I got to be the cast that succeed. I hope you will too. Father, I pray that your church this morning and over these past few weeks, I pray that they've heard a life or death message. It really is that. Lord, people that we are around each and every day, friends, loved ones, co-workers, they are one heartbeat away from an eternal punishment in a place of terrible torment. Let that sink into our hearts. May we also understand that they are one decision away from the glory of heaven for all eternity. Let that sink in. And I pray that these truths that we have been exploring in this glorious, wonderful parable the last few weeks, I pray, Lord, that these truths will just motivate us and move us to action. Help us to be vocal. Lord, we confess and we repent of our cowardice this morning. I confess mine. Times where I know I could speak up, times where I know I could share with somebody, and I don't. Forgive me, Lord, and embolden me by your Spirit to speak your truth in love, regardless of how I'm worried it's going to be received. We don't have time to worry about that. Father, this morning, if this seed has been cast, I pray that it's fallen on good ground, and if there's those here with us, or maybe even folks listening online, they're hearing this seed and they know that your Spirit is speaking powerfully to them this morning. And I'm praying, God, that you would bring forth the increase right now. As our heads are bowed, if there's anybody here this morning who says, Steve, I know you've been speaking to me these past few weeks, or maybe even today, I know in my heart of heart, I do not believe I'm a born-again child of God. That can change today. By faith, you can be reborn into the kingdom. If that's you, I'm not going to ask you to come forward and be prayed for. I want you to raise your hand so I know who I'm praying with and I can follow up with you later. Is there anybody quickly slip their hand up and say, please pray for me. I know I'm a sinner and I need salvation. Anyone, hand up and right back down. Praise God. Stand with me if you would. Well, Father in heaven, it has been good. Another great and glorious Lord's Day. And I thank you so much for these people. They're such a blessing to Lori and I just thank you, Lord, for their friendship and their love and their support. I thank you, God, for the work you're doing in all of our hearts. I just thank you, Lord, that we have these opportunities to come together in our midweek service. I thank you so much for the way you're building relationships and doing some good things there. God, we give you all the glory in it. And today, I just pray as we leave here, Lord, we are temples. We are your vessels filled with your Spirit. So as we leave here, Lord, we put on the Lord Jesus Christ and we make no provision for the flesh. Help us to walk in the Spirit each and every day, glorifying, honoring you. And again, I ask all this in the power of Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you, folks. Have a wonderful afternoon.